रियल लाइफ से। एलरी को नमस्कार आ आरटी वेलकम टू ज्ञान अर्जने एम्पावरिंग एक्सलेंस। फ्रेंड्स टुडे स्टडी सर्कल द टॉपिक इज टैक्सेबिलिटी ऑफ डिजिटल एंड ई कॉमर्स ट्रांजैक्शंस। टू इम्पार्ट नॉलेज इन दिस सब्जेक्ट वी हैव एमिनेंट स्पीकर अर्षिता केतन। She is going to enlighten us on this e-commerce and digital transaction taxability. So on behalf of Bangalore branch and on behalf of all the participants here, hearty welcome to Ashita. Hearty welcome, Ashita.
Thank you, sir.
Friends, I'll take a few minutes to inform about the Bangalore branch other programs. So day after tomorrow, Saturday, 15th May evening, we have 2-hour session on networking and corporate form of practice. CA Dayanima Sharma, our central council member, is going to inform us about the new networking guidelines of ICAI, and it is a 2-hour CPE session. There is no fee for that. I request all of you to register and understand how the new networking guidelines helps us to form more and more networking and make bigger and bigger firms. So I request you to register for that program and join us to learn more about networking. On 18th, another interesting session we have arranged, that is on from ticking to clicking businesses. It is basically a business advisory service or business consultancy services, how a chartered accountant become a business consultant. CA Sanjay Dhariwal is going to impart his knowledge on that topic. He is an experienced person as a business consultant. So I request all of you to register for that program. It is going to be a 3-hour CPE session. Please register for that. It is going to be a 3-hour session on 18th May. Please look into bangaloreicai.org and register for that program. In addition to that, we have arranged a workshop on wealth management. It is going to be a 4-day workshop. Each day, 3-hour session, 4 days, from 24th May to 1st June, 24th, 25th, 31st and 1st June, 4 days workshop on wealth management. Wealth management is going to be a lucrative area for chartered accountants. Many youngsters can look into that section and you can make a fabulous business in that wealth management. So many HNIs, our number is increasing in Bangalore. Is one of the fastest growing HNI city. So I request our members register to that wealth management workshop and learn more about wealth management. In addition to that, many new programs are coming up in the month of June. Succession plan, it is going to be a 3-day workshop. International taxation, it is going to be a 6-day workshop, and many more we are planning. So all the details you are going to get in bangaloreicai.org. With that note, once again, hearty welcome to each one of you. Hearty welcome, Ashita Ketan, once again. With that note, we have our regional council member. Echo aagta ide mani. Our regional council member, Geeta AB, is with us. Hearty welcome, Geeta. Madam Geeta, you are there? Hello. Hello. I think we lost connection. Now I request Divya to introduce our speaker, Ashita Ketan.
Thank you, Chairman. A very pleasant good evening to all the members and to a speaker of the day. I would like to give a brief introduction and welcome our speaker, Ms. Ashita Ketan. By qualification, she is chartered accountant and bachelor's of commerce from Sikkim Manipal University. Her areas of specialization are corporate taxation and international taxation. She is a qualified chartered accountant with 7 years of overall experience and handling corporate tax and legal matters. She began her career as an article assistant in direct tax at EY, and she has also worked with Deloitte's Huskins & Sells LLP. She has handled multinational clients across sectors such as manufacturing, software, automobiles, and e-commerce. She has also very closely worked with emerging startups and involved in dealing with various tax regulatory matters. She is also very much experienced in FEMA Companies Act RERA, and she has co-authored various articles and newsletters that have been published in tax journals, online tax platforms, and other media. She has also conducted training.
What happened, Divya?
Hello. Sir, am I not audible?
Yeah, now you are.
Sir, introduction, you know, was not audible, sir.
Audible, you go ahead.
Okay, I'll start from first.
Yeah.
Am I audible, sir, now?
Yes, you are.
Okay, thank you. So, members, I would like to introduce once again, sorry for the technical error. Ms. Ashrita, by qualification, she is Chartered Accountant and Bachelor's of Commerce from Sikkim Manipal University. Her areas of specialization are corporate taxation and international taxation. She is qualified Chartered Accountant with overall 7 years of experience in handling corporate tax and regulatory matters. She began her career as Article Assistant in Direct Tax at EY and also worked with Deloitte Haskins & Sells LLP. She has handled multinational clients across sectors such as manufacturing, software, e-commerce, automobile. She has also very closely worked with emerging startups and been involved in dealing with various tax regulatory matters. She's also having a good experience in other laws such as FEMA, Companies Act, RERA, etc. Ashrita has co-authored various articles and newsletters that have been published in tax journals, online tax platforms, and other media. She has also conducted training and webinar for various client personnel, government officials, and with industrial bodies on tax and regulatory issues. With this very brief introduction, I heartily welcome once again Ashrita for today's program.
Thank you, Divya.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Divya.
You're welcome.
Yes, please go ahead.
I'll
just quickly share my screen. Please let me know if it's visible. Is my screen visible?
Yes, it is visible.
Great. Thank you, sir. Thank you, dear members, for attending, and thank you to the Bangalore branch of ICI for giving me this opportunity to present today. I hope all of you all are doing safe, so is your family and all near and dear ones.
Please increase a little bit volume. I think a little low.
Sure, sir. Is it better now?
Please, a little more.
Okay. Better now?
Sorry?
Is it better now?
Yeah, a little better.
Great. So I was saying, I hope all of you all are doing well, keeping safe, and the same for your family and friends. I thank Bangalore branch of ICA for giving me this opportunity to present here. As we witness some of these unprecedented times, we are doing this on a virtual mode. It would have been great to meet all of you all personally, but maybe sometime soon. Having said that, so as we've evolved the way we live, the way businesses are conducted over the last 1 year, so have some of our tax laws. And there has been a mighty amendments that have come in and have impacted the way some of our businesses carried on. So today we will focus on one of the most emerging areas, which is digital and e-commerce sector. In the brief 2 hours that I have, I intend to cover some of these topics. We cannot proceed without discussing the Indian Apex Court ruling on the software matter, which was the elephant in the room until very recently. We'll speak about the equalization levy, which took everyone by storm when it was introduced last year. E-commerce transactions have a special place in the tax laws today, so it'd be interesting to look at that. And we'll also quickly go through some other tax considerations and regulatory matters that may impact businesses. And we have some quick case studies if time permits. Having said that, the digital economy today is much larger than what it was. At the beginning of the 20th century, everything was through brick and mortar stores. Nobody had presumed that we will reach a time when everything is done online. All our businesses, I don't think there are too many businesses that can exist today without having some form of digital presence. the digital footprint we are leaving is massive across the globe. India is playing a massive role in bringing about change in technology. We are leading technology from the front. The footprint in India itself today is 200 billion and is set to, the economy is set to rise to 1 trillion in the next 4 to 5 years. The internet users are also set to almost double in the next 2 to 3 years, with internet reaching the remotest areas of our country. Globally, it's now one global village. We are no longer restricted by land and sea borders. Trade has changed, the way businesses are carried out has changed. And as we witness some of these changes, it has become very important for our tax laws to also evolve with time. Way back in 1920, when the League of Nations first sat down to discuss international taxation, they came up with the concept of economic allegiance, where two basic concepts were placed most importance to. One was the physical presence of business, and second was from where the income was arising. Having placed importance to these two things, it became very simple. Wherever the brick and mortar store was located, that would be the place where the income was arising, and therefore the taxation rights were given to that place. This held good for most part of 20th century. Moving towards the later half and more towards the last decade of the century, we saw more of digital companies conducting business without having any form of presence in different countries. That made the whole system a little unfair. Countries and governments started questioning whether they have the adequate right to tax. With this came in the OECD G20 Council, which came up with BEPS, which is the base erosion and profit shifting module. A whole committee of experts sat down to evaluate how we need to change our tax laws, acknowledge the fact that businesses have evolved, and so there is a need to change our tax laws. They realized that there are three main problems that come up while we try to tax some of these transactions. The first one being nexus without a physical presence, which means that today I don't have a physical presence. I could be located anywhere in the world and conducting business, earning revenue from any other country in the world. So how do I create a nexus? How do I create a bridge and join these two dots? Then we came to value attribution. Today, how do I attribute a value? How do I know what, how do I divide my income into various sources? Because I'm sitting in one country working through 10 others. So how do I divide the value across these 10 countries? And then came the largest issue of characterization. Because are these goods, are these services, what kind of income is it? Is it royalty? Is it services? All of that was blurred. So as these lines were blurred, we realized that there is a massive need to evolve. And there were three suggestions, proposals that were set in Action Plan 1 of BEPS, which talks about digital taxation. The first one was a new nexus rule, which is the significant economic presence, which is to basically evolve from a brick and mortar physical presence to a rule that determines from where the business is actually operating, where the assets are located, where people are located, where the users and consumers are actually physically present, instead of where the service provider or the supplier is present. The second one was a form of withholding, which is one of the easier methods of taxation in the country today, where you just withhold on all kinds of digital payments. The third one was the equalization levy. So with these three proposals being laid on the table, we're still waiting global consensus, and which has been delayed over the years. And especially due to COVID, it has taken a bigger push. Countries started evolving and started adopting measures as and when they'd seemed fit. So DST, which is a digital service tax, was adopted by a lot of countries across the globe, largely the European countries and some parts of Africa, adopted DST at various levels. This was basically targeted at digital transactions that were undertaken in the country from a service provider that was outside the country. So if you take an example of country A, they were targeting companies located in any other country that were earning any form of income from country A by providing digital services, which was also there in the Action Plan 1. The second most important development that has slowly evolved and is yet to reach finality is significant economic presence. India has very recently notified the threshold limits, although it was introduced in India 4 years ago. However, the rules were notified very recently, being last month. A lot of other countries across the globe have also started putting together their SEP provisions, where they try to determine the presence of a company not by a physical office, but in terms of what transactions they're actually undertaking in their country. So these are two significant global developments that have happened and are yet to grow. We are yet to reach a global consensus. And we're yet to see what do we finally reach at the end of this journey. In the meantime, India has been at the forefront of some of these tax laws. We have been amongst the first few countries to implement some of these changes. Traditionally, we only looked at royalty and FTS taxation when we spoke of international transactions, apart from the permanent establishment. As we moved slowly towards the first part of the second part of the second decade of the 21st century, we introduced Equalization Levy 1, which was limited to online advertisements. Then came an Equalization Levy 2, which was for all kinds of digital transactions. There was a new section that came in for Section 194O, which was for e-commerce, and a GST also that came in. Apart from this, that's where we stand today. What we see ahead of us are the SEP regulations, which have just got notified. So we're yet to see how this will tie in with the existing regulations. There's also a OECD and UN level discussions, which are ongoing. The UN has already notified a 12B article, which is with regards to software taxation. There are new TCS, TDS provisions that have come in for various types of goods. There is an equalization levy that has come in for digital transactions. And it will be important to see how this new levy ties in with all of the new amendments that are yet to come in, because the intention of bringing an equalization levy was temporary, and it was supposed to stay till the time we reach global consensus. The first point that makes more sense to discuss is the Apex Court ruling on the software royalty tax. If we were discussing this about 5 years ago, maybe this was the biggest elephant in the room, as this was a matter of litigation for almost every company in Bangalore, especially as we being the IT hub of the country. And the highest precedence was set by the Karnataka High Court when they came up with rulings like the Samsung ruling, where even something as simple as an off-the-shelf software was regarded as royalty, which was right in opposition to a lot of other jurisdictions, such as the Delhi jurisdiction, which ruled in favor in the cases of Ericsson and Infrasoft. So across India, there were rulings being pronounced by various courts and by high courts and ITAT that were very, very different on principles, on facts. So there was an immediate need for all of this to be settled before the Supreme Court, as it was causing undue litigation. It was also causing a lot of anxiety to foreign taxpayers who wanted to enter India but were not sure about the tax positions that they should be adopting. Realizing the importance of this, the Supreme Court came up with a massive 226-page ruling that discussed software. It should be important to mention that the ruling of the Supreme Court goes back to software as it was almost a decade ago, which is very different from what it was today. Back then, software was given to us in CDs, floppy disks. It was more of a physical good. So the four transactions there were only four types of transactions that the Supreme Court primarily discussed. One was where there was a direct purchase, where you and I, a direct consumer, purchases from a non-resident supplier. The second one was where an Indian distributor purchases from a non-resident, distributes it to Indian users themselves. The third kind was where there is a foreign distributor who makes a foreign purchase and sells it to India. And the fourth kind was where you have a hardware which is embedded with the software and that is sold to India. So these were the four typical transactions that were covered by the software ruling. However, it is very important that the Supreme Court looked at a lot of various principles that could be applied and stretched on to how software is today. Although their case laws may differ on fact, but the principles that were discussed by the Supreme Court still hold good. The most important principle being the fact that the differentiated copyright and copyrighted article, which was one of the biggest contentions of tax authorities, they very clearly mentioned that as long as you don't have the right in the main code, as long as you don't have access to amend, transfer, or edit the main code that is beneath the software, you only are getting a copyrighted article and not access to the copyright. This was also acknowledged looking at some of the agreements, which are the end user license agreements, where the agreements were evaluated to clearly study that no rights were given to the end users to change anything that was in the software. So the end users were only given the license to use the software. They did not have any rights to change it, amend it, or make even further sales. Coming to Roy, then they also looked at very important principles of the OECD commentary, which has been a matter of litigation again, whether reliance can be placed on the OECD commentary or not. So the Supreme Court very rightly held that, you know, although you cannot, it does have a persuasive value, although it's not the final law, but the way the OECD commentary is worded definitely has a persuasive value in understanding tax treaties. tax officers have also very often held that a tax treaty position cannot be adopted, and the withholding tax obligations arise even if the transaction is taxable under the act, even if there is a benefit provided under the treaty. The Supreme Court has struck down this argument again, saying that a withholding tax obligation will arise only if the transaction is taxable both under the treaty as well as the tax laws. Having said that, so that settles a very, very important principle that was litigated. The key area that came up for software taxation was the retrospective amendment that came in 2012. So tax officers were again expecting taxpayers to comply with this from way before 2012. Where the Supreme Court again recognized the impossibility of performance and said that a retrospective amendment, you cannot expect taxpayers to comply with a retrospective amendment that did not even exist when the transaction took place. Also, the retrospective amendment cannot impact your tax treaties. So these are some of the principles that come out of the Supreme Court ruling, which are very, very relevant, even in terms of software as it stands today, and a lot of allied rulings that we will discuss in the following slides. Having said this, Karnataka jurisdiction being one of the most unfavorable in terms of software, have already issued two new rulings which were in favor of the taxpayer. So this goes a long way to say that it is hopeful that as we move ahead, this issue should be settled and should provide some relief to taxpayers. So having provided some relief to taxpayers, what remains to be evaluated are some of these key points which I thought are worth discussing. So where you have a no royalty position that is taken, so you have a non-resident today from whom you're purchasing software, you take a no royalty position because of the Supreme Court ruling, which is absolutely fine. But there is a new equalization levy that's coming, and that applies on all digital transactions. So technically, even though you're out of the software taxation bubble, you enter the equalization levy bubble. So you have a new law to evaluate now. There are four categories of transactions for which the Supreme Court has said that these are as goods, and therefore there is no royalty payment because there is no royalty on goods. So now if we take a goods position, then what happens to domestic sales? Because the transactions here were considered as goods under the tax treaties. So do I take a similar reading for domestic transfer of software, or do I not take that? Secondly, if it is goods, then we have some TDS provisions and TCS provisions that have been newly introduced for transfer of goods. Will these apply? Some of these provisions are discussed in the following slides, and we can go through them in detail. There's also another issue that comes up for resellers. So there was a CBDT notification of 2012, which specifically mentions that in case of a reseller, if the transaction had suffered taxation when he had purchased the software from the NR distributor, any further sale will not attract TDS, provided due declarations and other documents are provided. Now, if the reseller takes a no royalty position for purchase of software from the non-resident, then can he hold good? Then the CBD notification may not hold good, and he may have to be obligated for TDS deduction when he further sells it. So there could be a TDS that is deducted when he makes a further sale. So which means the liability has now shifted. The other strong argument that the Supreme Court relied while delivering this judgment was the fact that they did not have a PIN in India. Therefore, it is sale of goods which cannot be taxed in India in the absence of a PIN. So do we see tax officers that are going to run after companies asking them to prove whether they have a PE in India or not becomes very important. Therefore, companies must make sure that they build a strong fort around their PE position, and they well guard this position. They have enough documents, so all of these issues do not come up before the tax officer. The last and most important for international tax rulings are the transfer pricing agreements under APA and MAPS. We will have to go to evaluate whether some of these agreements can be relooked at, because these are pre-negotiated agreements, and the bearing the Supreme Court ruling will have on these agreements should be discussed. Having said this, for people who are already under litigation, there are a lot of companies that have open litigation pending for this, and there are some which have accepted the position of the taxpayers or have already deposited taxes. So what do these companies do? I think the first and foremost thing for every company, irrespective of which bucket they fall in, is to reassess some of their contracts, because a lot of foreign companies tend to pass on the withholding obligation as well as the cost to the Indian buyer. In that case, the Indian buyer does a gross up and pays the TDS separately to the government and pays the full invoice value to the foreigner. Now, having said that, where there is a no position is taken, or no TDS position is taken, then there should be a need to reassess this, as there will be no requirement to withhold taxes, and that should save some cost even for the Indian purchasers. There's also a new form 15E that has been recently notified, which is where an Indian payer making any payment to a non-resident could file a form 15E to obtain a nil or a lower withholding. So earlier, nil and lower withholding could only be obtained by the taxpayer himself. Now the buyer who has the TDS obligation on him can obtain this on behalf of the non-resident, which will help him better assess the tax liability and accordingly withhold taxes. So this becomes very relevant where the payouts are substantial. We can reach out to the tax officers, understand what my tax liability should be, and then withhold taxes based on the tax liability assessed by the tax officer. Where we have open litigation going on, this is a very good case to place an additional ground. There have been instances where additional grounds have been accepted. However, with faceless assessments and faceless appeals having come in, the procedure for placing an additional ground is yet to be notified, and we'll have to check how that works under the new scheme of things. A revision application is also possible for closed assessments and appeals, where an additional ground may not be possible. The Chief Commissioner has the discretion to accept the revision appeal, and he can also revise the order in favor of the taxpayer. If not, we always have the High Court to go back to. Foreign taxpayers can file tax returns, claim back an excess refund, provided the window to file the tax return is still open. There's also a procedure to obtain condonation. However, these are far-fetched and should be used only when the amounts are substantial. In case they are not, then the cost of some of these may be higher than the benefit that comes out of it. The Indian payers also have the option to revise the tax returns where they themselves have paid the TDS out of their own pockets. However, if the foreign company has claimed a tax credit of this in their home jurisdiction, then there could be an issue. So these are some very interesting opportunities that open up for all of us to discuss with our clients and to see where they could fall and what best could be done for them for contracts that have already been closed and for proposed transactions in the future. As I was mentioning earlier, the Supreme Court verdict has a far-fetched impact on a lot of other transactions which did not exist back then, but are closely linked to software. First one being database subscription, then there's network committee, there is interface processor, intranet, advertisement, submarine cable. These are just some of the massive buckets of transactions which deal with software and related type of payments. There's also software as a service. There are multiple buckets. There have been favorable and unfavorable rulings in most of these cases. Some of the unfavorable rulings are listed here. It will be really interesting to reevaluate some of these rulings in light of the Supreme Court ruling and see whether any of them go on appeal, what is the mechanism that is followed for all of these cases. Having put this elephant to rest, the next thing that comes up is the equalization levy. It is something that took the country by storm when it was introduced. It came in two parts. The first part was Equalization Levy 1, which came in 2016. This came as more of a withholding obligation on the Indian payer, which was to be at the rate of 6% if the transaction with a non-resident exceeded 1 lakh rupees during the year. This was also restricted only for B2B transactions. So today, if I, as an individual and the end consumer, if I enter into a transaction, that would not suffer, I would not be required to do an equalization levy deduction. However, if I was a business carrying out business activities and entered into an advertisement related transaction, I would be required to do this. It was also not applicable for NRs having a PE in India. Now, some of the specified services that this equalization levy covered, which usually targeted advertisement payments, was any form of online advertisement providing a digital advertising space. Anything that was related to an advertisement space was also covered. Specific exclusions were for B2C, as I mentioned. So anyone who was the end consumer was not required to withhold this tax. Again, the reason there being that it casts a withholding similar to a withholding obligation on the payer. So keeping the end consumers out of it, and to make it easy for them, they were kept out of equalization levy one. What is very important to evaluate while discussing equalization levy is whether I can get a credit of the taxes claimed. The reason being that when equalization levy came in, it was a part of the Finance Act and was not really a part of the Income Tax Act, whereas the tax treaties are restricted to Income Tax Act and the provisions therein. Therefore, if equalization levy is considered outside the Income Tax Act, a credit for this might not be available, which means it could be an added cost for the non-resident. And more likely than not, the non-resident might enter into contracts where they wish to pass on the cost to the Indian payer by a grossing up mechanism, which is very similar in our TDS, regular TDS work. Apart from this, even if the burden is passed on, there was a huge compliance burden for the resident payer. So although this targets the non-residents, the compliance burden stays with the resident payer. The compliance obligations are discussed later in the slides. So all of this has to be done by the resident payer for equalization levy one. Again, very similar to a TDS withholding. The NR is not required to do any kind of compliance in India. This was simpler, was digested well. Then came equalization levy two as a surprise in the Finance Act 2020. It was not a part of the finance bill, and then it came as a part of the Finance Act. There were amendments made in the Finance Act 2021 also. Here, what is very important to look at is they try to cover all forms of digital transactions. Any kind of online sale from an e-commerce operator is covered. Any provision of services is covered, and any form of combination of this is also covered. Now, when I say online sale of goods, online provision of services, there is no specific definition. However, this budget has amended it to include things like acceptance of offer, just placing, just negotiating, sending emails to confirm orders, deciding, negotiating, all of that, if done online, could trigger equalization levy. It does leave a very big question open on how far-fetched is this levy, because if I'm just placing an order through email, which is the easiest mode of communication, then, and if I'm taking a physical delivery of these goods, then will equalization levy still apply to me? And is it fair, and is that the intent of the law? That is a question that remains open in front of us. However, as the law stands today, it covers even a part of the transaction being undertaken online as applicable for equalization levy. The term online again is defined to mean any kind of internet or digital or telecommunication network. So it might just not be a website. An email could also be online. Equalization levy is specifically applicable to any transaction that is entered into with a person resident in India or a person who buys goods or services using an IP address in India. So if the IP address is in India and if I'm located anywhere outside, I will still be covered for a recipient, and equalization levy will apply on the person transacting with me. Non-residents under specified circumstances are also covered. The specified circumstances are sale of advertisement targeting Indian customers or sale of data collected from Indian users. So if we have foreign websites that are selling advertisements to specified Indian customers, even if they are located outside India, then they would fall under equalization levy 2 and not equalization levy 1. So it is a specific carve out that has been made for advertisement targeting Indian customers and data collection. Coming to non-applicability, the list is small but important. Any non-resident e-commerce operator having a PE in India is not covered. If equalization levy 1 is applicable, equalization levy 2 will not apply. Any non-resident having a turnover less than 20 million, INR 20 million will not be required to comply with equalization levy. This is a per annum turnover. So if during that year your turnover is below 20 million, you will not be required to comply with equalization levy 2. However, if your turnover exceeds this threshold, then on the total amount you will be required. So it is not an additional. So anything that exceeds 20 million, on the entire amount, equalization levy at 6% will be, at 2% will be applicable. A key exclusion that was made in the budget was for e-commerce transactions that are entered into where the seller or the service provider is in India. So if we have a foreign e-commerce operator that is selling goods to an Indian customer, and the seller of these goods is also an Indian, then the equalization levy 2 will not apply. This is because there are specific provisions under the Income Tax Act which would apply. Having said these, a very important point here to discuss is that for some companies, e-commerce operators located outside India and selling goods to Indians, it is important for them to bifurcate between what goods are sold by resident sellers and what goods are sold by non-resident sellers, because only what is sold by non-resident sellers will be liable to equalization levy. Another key point that came up, that comes up during the discussion for equalization levy, is the fact that the equalization levy will apply on the gross amount of consideration. So typically in an e-commerce model, where you have the operator who collects the total value, including the value of the goods. So if there are goods that are sold worth 100 rupees, the e-commerce operator collects the 100 rupees, deducts of out of his commission and other charges and passes on the balance to the seller. So if he withholds, say, 2 rupees, he passes on 98 to the seller. The 2 rupees is the real income of the e-commerce operator, and the balance 98 rupees is the income of the seller. However, the equalization levy provisions as they stand today talk about having a gross amount. So the e-commerce operator that's collecting 100 rupees may have to deposit 2% of the entire 100 rupees as equalization levy, which was also not his income in the first place. So that is something that is massive, it's vast, and could have a substantial impact on e-commerce operators. Having said this, and working with clients globally, we've seen companies like Apple that have passed on the cost to the consumers. That means the 2% has been marked up in the invoice value. So if I pay for an Apple product in India, they have specific terms and conditions which say that the price is 2% higher to make up for equalization levy. Whereas there are companies like Netflix that have decided to absorb the cost. So companies today are still deciding which side they want to swing. However, it is something that has made their brains tick and is requires deep evaluation. As I was mentioning earlier, there's an overarching impact that this levy has because the scope is vast, the number of transactions are vast, and it covers any form that is any form of a transaction that is undertaken on a digital platform. Therefore, a very important question that comes up is what happens to intercompany transactions? So today it's very, very common for MNCs to use common platforms, common ERPs between their head office and the subsidiary. And the subsidiary often pays their head office for these payments. These are for ERP again, which is a digital transaction. So does that mean on intra-group transactions, there could be an equalization levy? This becomes a very important question today because this was never the intent of law. The intent of law was to plug in the loophole of businesses that were making income in India but were not paying taxes. In case of intra-group transactions, this is merely a distribution. This is merely a common platform that was being used. It was beyond the intent of law, and this has also been mentioned by various experts. So there's a definite need for the government to relook at this and to come up with clarifications. Countries that have adopted digital tax have specifically excluded this. So there are countries like UK, Spain, and France that have specifically carved out intra-group transactions. And we hope that the government of India will also come up with clarifications in this regard. These are some of the compliances that are very, very important in the equalization levy. So the compliances are similar for 1 and 2. However, the compliance obligation differs. For equalization levy 1, it is similar to a withholding where the payer has to withhold the taxes deposited to the government treasury by the 7th of the following month. In case of equalization levy 2, it is the NR e-commerce operator who is supposed to himself deposit to the government on a quarterly basis. So this the dates are mentioned upfront. So it is the 7th of the next month ending the quarter, and it is 31st March for the last quarter. The importance here, it is that it is the e-commerce operator who needs to deposit this. A copy of the challan, which is challan 285, which holds good for both equalization levy 1 and 2, specifically requires furnishing a PAN and an Indian bank account. Which means to say that all NR e-commerce operators that are subject to equalization levy in the country will be required to obtain a PAN and will also require an Indian bank account to make the payment. Now, I understand that there are foreign banks that have the facility of SNRR accounts where you can open these accounts only for facilitation of payments. However, the PAN obligation continues. There is also an annual statement called Form 1. Which applies to both equalization levy 1 and 2, which is required to be filed by 30th June of the immediately following year. So for the year, financial year 2021, that has just gotten over, the due date is 30th June. Form 1 is required to be filed by the payer in case of equalization levy 2, in equalization levy 1, and the non-resident e-commerce operator in case of equalization levy 2. The government's been quite stringent and wants to make sure that this is implemented right up first. So they've also come up with interest and penal consequences. There is an interest deduction, and there's also a penalty that has been imposed. What is important again here is that the penalty that has been imposed is something that can be litigated. However, the only form of appeal that is allowed is against penalty orders. So today, if my equalization levy is assessed and a penalty order is issued, I can only appeal against the penalty order, and I cannot appeal against the main equalization levy. So this becomes a key area as something that cannot be appealed. How good does it hold before the court of law is a question we must all think about. Having said this, the principal chief commissioner of income tax, international taxation cell, has been notified as the jurisdictional officer. He has appointed ACITs and DCITs that will be overlooking equalization levy. A key point that has caused issue for some of the non-resident companies is the fact that there is no refund mechanism available. So if a company deposits additional equalization levy and tries to play safe, there is no mechanism currently to obtain a refund for this. Therefore, it may be an additional cost that the companies take. Therefore, what we have observed is the collection from equalization levy 1 and 2 have not been substantial. Although, if we look at the data from 2019 to 2020, there has been a substantial rise. We must understand that this is not completely on account of equalization levy 2, and it is just a year-on-year rise that was anyway happening. Companies today are trying to go back, evaluate their position, understand whether these tax laws would apply to them, and then take a position with regards to equalization levy 2. We've had multiple cases of companies reaching out to us, and there have been instances where equalization levy 2 was applicable to them, and they have been forced to evaluate what kind of pricing models they want to imply, whether they want to absorb the cost or whether they want to pass it on to their customers. With regards to equalization levy, this was for all kinds of foreign transactions. Now, coming to the e-commerce operators in India, there have been specific laws that have been implemented. The first one is a TDS on e-commerce transactions. This came in October, on October 1st, 2020. This applies to e-commerce operators located in India. If you have an e-commerce operator that is a resident or a non-resident, you will have a TDS. However, if the seller is a non-resident, it will be equalization levy. If the seller on the e-commerce platform is a resident, it will be TDS on e-commerce. So this is where the key bifurcation is. This does not directly apply based on the e-commerce operator. It applies based on where the seller is located, and that's the seller who's selling through a platform. So this TDS is applicable in a typical scenario where there are three different parties. So we have an e-commerce operator, we have a buyer who uses this e-commerce platform to buy goods, and we have a seller who lists his products on the e-commerce platform. To clarify, this will not apply in case of direct transactions. So an equalization levy would apply in case of direct sales from a non-resident. However, the TDS on e-commerce will not apply in case of direct sales through my own website. So if a seller sells goods through his own website, TDS on e-commerce will not apply. It requires three parties to exist. Having said this, it is a 1% TDS. It is a normal TDS that has been introduced under Section 194O. It applies to any e-commerce operator being a resident or a non-resident. The tax has to be deducted at the time of credit or payment, whichever is earlier. It is mandatory for the seller to quote his PAN or Aadhaar. And in cases where this is not quoted, the tax rate is bumped up from 1% to 5%. The non-applicability is very limited to individuals and HUFs where the turnover is less than 5, the sales made from the platform is less than 5 lakhs and a PAN and Aadhaar is furnished. This is to ensure that the small individual sellers who use the e-commerce platforms are not impacted by this, and the target audience continues to remain the big players. Also, a specific exclusion has been made for online posting of advertisements. Having said this, one of the most important observations that were made while going through this section was the fact that in a typical e-commerce transaction, the money usually flows from the buyer to the e-commerce platform to the seller. If there are scenarios where the amount is directly paid to the seller, then what happens? There could be a transaction, say when I book a cab, or if I have some professional services that I obtain in my house, there could be a scenario where I make the booking through the platform, but the payment is directly made to the service provider. In this case, the section specifically carves out and says that even if the payment is directly made to the service provider, it will be deemed that the payment has been made through the e-commerce operator. And therefore, there will be a liability for the e-commerce operator to withhold taxes. So in such a scenario, if I have already made the payment, the TDS obligation that arises on that will have to be collected by the e-commerce operator from the service provider and deposited to the government. So So this is a massive step and an additional compliance that has been put on e-commerce operators, and they will have to relook at their business models to ensure that they duly comply with this provision. Services of even FTS and professional services are covered. So even if I book a professional service through an app and I make a direct payment, it will still, the Section 194O will continue to apply. Having said this, some of the key things that have not been included and clarifications are awaited is what happens in case of a sales return or discounts and vouchers, because this is applicable on the gross amount. So today, if I have purchased a product and TDS has been withheld on that when the e-commerce operator made the final payment to the seller, and tomorrow, if I return this product, then what happens? Can the transaction be reversed? Will the TDS be set off against future transactions? These are points that remain open and are yet to be clarified. Another important clarification that came in was the fact that this will not apply to payment gateways, because in case of payment gateways, there are two e-commerce operators and it becomes a much complex model. The idea is to keep the trigger in hands of the e-commerce platform through which the sale is actually facilitated. Therefore, so 194O becomes important for e-commerce operators to look at, to evaluate, and to ensure that the mechanism is built into their systems to withhold taxes and to avoid any kind of disallowance. I'm no expert in GST, but I thought it would be important to mention that GST also has a similar provision, which is a TCS under GST at the rate of 1%. Surprisingly, the GST law is fairly easier in terms of the specification of the net transaction value, which says that any sales return or discount can be adjusted, and therefore only the net value will suffer GST. So that's a relief that has been provided. However, the compliance burden and the GST is massive, as e-commerce operators are required to obtain a registration in every state where there is a seller and goods are sold. So an e-commerce operator that is registered in city A will also have to obtain registrations in all other states where they sell goods to. This is a massive step and has caused a lot of uproar in the industry, because it's very, because at the beginning of the year or at the beginning of a month, it is very hard to say through to which state will I be making sales. Today, most of e-commerce operators cater to the whole of India, which means that there could be a requirement to obtain a registration in each of these states. TCS and the GST is also applicable to a three-party transaction as discussed for Section 194O. There's a specific exclusion that's been made for hotel accommodation for unregistered people, passenger transport such as cabs, radio taxi, and for housekeeping services. These are transactions to which TCS and the GST will not apply. TCS has to be remitted by the 10th of the following month, and there is also a GSTR 8 which is required to be filed. There's also the requirement to furnish an annual statement. Now, the credit mechanism is a little different for TCS and the GST. Instead of a direct credit, the amount that is collected by the e-commerce operator is deposited to the electronic cash ledger of the seller, and the seller can use the credit in the electronic ledger to net off and pay any other future GST tax liability. There is also a GSTR Form 2A that has been notified, which is for sellers to match this. So now, to summarize, both equalization levy and the domestic tax provisions, wherever there is a non-resident seller, there will be a requirement to do equalization levy. And the buyer should be in India, of course. Wherever the seller is in India and the e-commerce operator is either resident or non-resident, we have a domestic tax TDS provision under 194O and a TCS under GST. So that way, the government has tried to plug in all kinds of transactions, both domestic and international, and has also tried to ensure that there is no double taxation that comes through. There are a lot of other laws that were introduced over the last 1 year that could apply to some of the digital transactions. The first and foremost is a new TCS and TDS. So the first leg is the TCS that was introduced last year. This was applicable from October 2020. It is a TCS obligation cast on the seller who has a turnover of more than 100 million and a sales consideration of more than 5 million. So if I am a seller who whose turnover is more than 100 million and I'm entering into a sale transaction where the sale consideration is more than 5 million, I'm required to collect 0.1% of the sum exceeding 5 million. So if it's a 6 million transaction, I will collect 0.1% of the exceeding 1 million. This will be collected at the time of receipt. Also, a higher rate of 1% is prescribed where PAN or Aadhaar is not furnished. A similar provision came in this budget, which will become applicable from July 1st, 2021. This is a TDS obligation, which is the exact mirror of the TCS obligation. This is basically to plug in the loophole where the seller's turnover is lower. However, the transaction is a large value transaction. So in this scenario, the buyer is required to do a TDS where his turnover exceeds 100 million and the purchases are more than 5 million. And the rate remains the same. However, if you do not furnish a PAN, instead of 1% TCS, this is a 5% TDS. This again is at the time of payment or credit, whichever is earlier, like any other TDS provision. So these are two mirror provisions that have been introduced to ensure where either one of the party has a turnover of greater than 100 million and is entering into transactions of more than 5 million, there is a TDS or TCS obligation cast. Having said this, these being new provisions, there are again lots of challenges and considerations that have come up. One thing the government has clarified is the TDS obligation will override the TCS obligation. Therefore, if in a scenario where both apply, the TDS will override the TCS, the obligation will be on the buyer. Also, TDS is applicable where there are non-resident buyers. So although TCS specifically excludes exports, but TDS does not have any such exclusion. So if there is a non-resident buyer who's buying goods from India that are more than 5 million and his turnover is more than 100 million, there is a TDS obligation, which means that the buyer may be required to obtain a TAN and fulfill this obligation. So is this TDS provision extraterritorial and do we have the right to have such provisions in our law is something that can be questioned. There is also the blurred definition of goods. As the term goods are not defined under the Income Tax Act, we borrow definitions from the Sales of Goods Act and from the GST law. The Supreme Court recently said software are goods. So in such a scenario, will these TDS and TCS provisions apply? There is also the big bucket of securities. With regards to securities, the government has specifically said that any listed security will be out of the ambit of TDS and TCS. But what happens to unlisted securities? That's a question that continues to bother people as there are enough people who undertake transactions of greater than 5 million in securities. Another very important question, as there was earlier, is what happens to sales return and purchase returns? Because again, today, if I do a TDS, there is high chances that there will be a return. There might be credit notes that are issued. So in this scenario, do I also issue a similar note for the tax that I withheld or I collected? The other requirement is that the TDS provisions override TCS provisions. So today, is it right for a seller to assume that the buyer has done TDS and therefore there is no requirement to do TCS? If both these provisions apply, it's likely that the seller should obtain a declaration from the buyer saying that TDS has been done and therefore there is no requirement to do a TCS and there are no non-compliance that can be handed over to the seller. So these are two sections that go hand in hand, and it's a tightrope that needs to be walked carefully to ensure that one of the parties is meeting the obligation and therefore the other party does not face non-compliance. Another new section that came in this budget and is set to be effective from July 1st is a higher rate for non-filing of tax returns. So this is a simple provision which says that your rate will be 2x of the specified rate or 5%, whichever is higher. If the person has not furnished his tax returns for 2 years and the TDS TCS credit available during such 2 years was either 50,000 or more for each of the years. To simplify, today if I'm withholding taxes, I need to know that the person I have entered into a transaction with has filed his tax returns for 2 years. If not, the TDS TCS credit is less than 50,000. If these conditions are not met, then I'm required to do TDS or TCS at double the rate or 5%, whichever is higher. Some transactions that have been kept out of the ambit are for salary, withdrawal of EPF, lottery winnings, and cash withdrawal in excess of 10 million. Now, a key point that came in is the fact whether the person has filed his tax returns. These are highly confidential documents. Today, no person will provide me with his tax returns or even an acknowledgement because that has key financial information mentioned on it. So while discussing this at various forums, the CBDT has promised that they will soon come up with a mechanism where I can figure out whether the person I've transacted with has filed his tax returns in the past 2 years and what his TDS and TCS credit numbers were. So based on this mechanism, which is yet to be notified, taxpayers will be able to check whether the people transacting with have filed their tax returns and what would be the right rate of TDS and TCS. In the meantime, we've also had cases where people have requested for a screenshot from the website of the e-filing portal as substantial proof of filing the tax return. So that's something the companies have already started doing. However, we wait to see what the CBDT has to say and the mechanism that they prescribe. Now, this being a complex web of transactions, this is a quick flowchart to understand what rates will typically apply. So as the TDS provision overrides TCS, we start by checking the turnover of the buyer. If the buyer's turnover is more than 100 million, and if he's entering into a transaction more than 5 million, there will be a requirement for him to do TDS. Where a valid PAN is furnished and ITR has been filed for 2 years, it will be a standard rate of 0.1% under Section 194Q. Where the seller has not furnished returns for 2 years and the TDS credit is lower, then there is the higher rate of TDS of 5% will be applicable. Now, in case the buyer's turnover is more than 100 million, but the purchase value is less than 5 million, then there's no requirement to do TDS. Where the buyer is a party with lower than 100 million turnover, then we check what happens to the seller, because then the TCS provisions could apply. Where the seller satisfies the conditions of 100 million turnover and a transaction value of 5 million, and the buyer has filed his tax returns, then again we come back to the base rate of 0.1%. Where returns have not been filed, there is a higher rate of 5%. The rate of 5% is because the specified rate is 0.1, 2 times of the rate would be 0.2. The third condition is 5%. So it becomes higher of 0.2% or 5%, therefore the 5% rate. Where even the seller does not have a turnover greater than 5 million or the transaction value is not greater than 5 million, then there will be no TCS obligation. So therefore, this is a very helpful chart for a single party transaction, which could be used to evaluate what are the tax rates that could apply and under which section I have to comply. Coming back again to a very interesting GST provision, to keep it very, very brief, there is a new GST on OIDAR. This is specifically for B2C. A little bit of history here is, today, if I was a service provider in India, a registered Indian service provider, I will be required to comply with GST irrespective of whether it is a B2B or a B2C transaction. Now, on the flip side, if I'm a non-resident service provider and I enter into a B2B transaction, there is a reverse charge mechanism. So there is a GST obligation that is being met by the service recipient. However, if this is a B2C transaction, then these parties are specifically excluded from reverse charge, which means that these transactions go tax-free where GST is considered. To plug in this loophole, there was a new GST that was introduced, which is only for service OIDAR service providers for B2C transactions. Now, OIDAR services specifically include advertisement, cloud services, providing content, data access, data storage, any other form of online claiming. So if I'm a service provider who's entered into these transactions with the B2C, who's basically an end user like you and me, then there is an obligation cast on the service provider himself to get a simplified registration and deposit GST at the rate of 18%. There is a simple registration that has been prescribed. The service provider can also have someone in India depositing taxes on behalf of the service provider. Now, it's become important for service providers to understand how will they know from where the customer is accessing these services, and how do they evaluate on what portion should they deposit GST. The Supreme Court has understood this issue that is being faced by taxpayers, and a PIL has been issued to the government requesting them to come out with a mechanism that helps OIDAR non-resident service providers to determine what would be the tax liability. This is closely tied in with equalization levy, because today, even in equalization levy, it becomes very difficult for a foreign service provider or supplier of goods to understand how much income comes from India. This goes back to the basic value attribution challenge that we had discussed earlier. And the government should likely come up with value attribution even for equalization levy, as they would for GST. And the another interesting point here is equalization levy will apply to both B2C and B2B transactions. So the income tax brackets are much wider. The issues remain similar. Now, this again is a complex web of various taxes that would apply. We've tried to put together the GST law, income tax, and equalization levy for a couple of transactions. I'll keep this low. In case there are questions, I'll be happy to take them at the end. Now, if we have cross-border transactions where the e-commerce operator is located outside India and there is a resident supplier. So we have someone resident in India who's selling goods on a foreign platform to a resident customer, then there is a TCS under GST. There is also TDS under Section 194O. Here, it is a TDS and not an equalization levy because the supplier is a resident in India. So it's typically a transaction between a resident supplier and a resident purchaser through a non-resident platform. So only the platforms outside India, the other two parties are in India. Where the supplier is also a non-resident, which is typically an import case, then GST also does not apply, as customs duty would apply in that case. Income tax will not apply because the supplier is outside India and an equalization levy will apply. So basically, this is a case of import, which is why there's no GST and there is an equalization levy. The non-resident supplier and a resident purchaser. Software, although it has been settled before the Supreme Court, again, whether it is goods or services is something that remains open. Although typical shrink wrap off-the-shelf software can be considered as goods, we do have a concept of software as a service. So will that fall under the goods bucket is questionable. Therefore, where I think that the software I'm purchasing is goods, then and I take a no royalty position in lines with the Supreme Court ruling, then there is an equalization levy of 2%, because this is a non-resident cross-border transaction. Equalization levy is specifically not applicable in case it is a royalty. Therefore, I first check for royalty. If royalty does not apply, I check for equalization levy. I'm taking a no royalty position because of the Supreme Court ruling. Therefore, I will pay equalization levy. Now, if I think software is a service, then I need to check if this will be FTS, which is fees for technical services. If I think it is not FTS, then again, I fall back into the equalization levy bracket. So typically, this is to summarize that any software transaction with a non-resident still can be subject to tax under equalization levy if it is out of income tax. There is also the direct sale of goods and services. If it is goods, then we'll have to test for PE. If it is services, I'll have to test for FTS under the DTAA. Where both of these are not met, then there is a 2% equalization levy. So if there is no PE and if it is not FTS, I will still fall under the 2% levy. So under all these transactions, it is important to see that either I will be taxed under the Income Tax Act or under equalization levy, which was the absolute intent of law. Now, coming to domestic transactions, just to compare it with what happens with non-residents, in domestic transactions, there will obviously be no equalization levy, as that was intended only for cross-border transactions. If there is a resident supplier and a resident e-commerce platform, we have a TCS under GST as well as the TDS under Section 194O. If there is a non-resident supplier who's selling goods through a resident platform, then none of it will apply because it's a simple sale of goods. And that's import under the Income Tax Act. It will be tested for PE. Now, if I look at software again as goods and services, it's the same thing. If I take a no royalty position, this is a domestic transaction. So if I want to still take this position of no royalty, it is something I'll have to test. If I do take that position, it means I'm saying my software is in the nature of goods. And therefore, the newly introduced TDS TCS provisions of 0.1% will have to be applicable. If I think that the software that I am transacting with is service and is not in the nature of goods, then there could still be a withholding under 194J. I can again check if I want to adopt the Supreme Court principles, but that's something that will have to be litigated and discussed. So this is a very complex system of taxation that has come up. However, it is important to understand that the loopholes that existed till today have been plugged in, and there will be some form of taxation at each leg and for each type of transaction. So this is how typically e-commerce transactions as well as digital transactions are taxed today and will be in the coming financial year. Something that's just happened over the last week is the significant economic presence. This was notified in the past. However, the rules were not notified yet. There were thresholds that just came in last week. Without the thresholds, the provisions were not really effective. the provisions were set to be effective from 1st April 2021. So this is to define the definition of business connection under Section 9. So Section 9 of the Income Tax Act talks about cases where the non-resident will be taxable in India. Section 9.1 talks about business connection. The definition of business connection has now been expanded to include transaction for any goods, services, or property carried out by non-resident with any person in India. This definition was later amended to even include download of data or software in India. The threshold that has been prescribed is 20 million. And this is one condition. This one or the second one being systematic and continuous soliciting of business activities from more than 0.3 million users in India. So if either of these two conditions are met, then it is likely that the non-resident will be regarded to have a significant economic presence or an SEP in India. Any profit that which is similar to a PE concept when we talk about tax treaties. So any profit that is attributable to the SEP in India will become taxable in India, and India will have the taxation rights. Having said this, some of the very important points here to be kept in mind. First and foremost, this is not a part of the treaty discussions. Today, India's treaties does not have an SEP clause. Therefore, if there is a jurisdiction that I'm interacting with whom I have a tax treaty, then the provisions of the tax treaty will be more beneficial and will override the provisions of the Income Tax Act. So I may be a non-resident that has transactions of greater than 20 million. I could have an SEP in India, but under Article 5 of the relevant tax treaty, I will be able to claim the benefit and I will be able to say that I do not have a PE in India and therefore no business income should be taxable in India. So today, SEP as it stands, although it is the thresholds are low, it is something when compared to the digital footprint in the country, these do not really affect companies that have a tax treaty. There is also a concept of beneficial ownership that needs to be tested in the tax treaty to ensure that I can claim the benefits available therein. So that is a very important interplay with tax treaties. There are countries where we do not have tax treaties, like say the Cayman Islands or the British Virgin. There could be a significant impact if I'm transacting with a non-resident. Having said this, profit attribution rules are yet to be notified. Definition of goods, services, property, systematic and soliciting data, all of this has not been defined yet. It will be interesting to see how these are defined. Where the definition is kept wide, it might have significant impact because the thresholds are low. Also, it will be interesting to see how India goes on to amend some of these tax treaties, because it's only then that SEP will really show its true colors. The idea of SEP and equalization levy functioning together is something that should be evaluated, because today, as equalization levy stands, the first check is royalty or FTS. If there is no royalty FTS and there is no PE in India, equalization levy will apply on any digital transaction with a non-resident. Therefore, SEP may not apply. As soon as equalization levy applies, there's SEP that gets ruled out because there's a specific exemption under the Income Tax Act. Therefore, what is left for SEP to apply are tangible goods. Now, that's the next question, is do we really want to tax tangible goods? Is that the intent of law? As it stands today, it looks like it does want to tax even tangible goods. And therefore, there might not be too much of an interplay because equalization levy will already cover any digital transaction. With so much happening in India, we were bound to raise eyebrows across the globe. We have got the attention of the USTR in America, where they have initiated an investigation against the equalization levy imposed by India. So what the government of the USA has to say is that equalization levy is extraterritorial. It is not fair and discriminatory against US companies. This is mostly because the largest chunk of tech companies operating in India are from the US. So those are the contentions placed by the USTR in stating that equalization levy is discriminatory and against the principles of international tax. India has submitted a very strong response stating that equalization levy is something that came in under Action Plan 1. It was a proposal made by them. It meets all international tax practices and is no way discriminatory because it is not restricted to any other country. So equalization levy applies to any country and is not restricted to the USA. Secondly, it is also not discriminatory because there are domestic tax laws that tax domestic Indian taxpayers. It was only the non-residents that were outside this tax purview, and therefore equalization levy has come in to make sure that there is no discrimination. the government of the USA was not very happy with our response, and as a retaliatory measure, there has been an additional tariff of 25% on certain goods. There is a public hearing that is scheduled, and we'll have to wait and watch on what actions are taken up. With the Biden government coming in, we may have to see how India retaliates and what is done to settle this fire. Another very interesting discussion at the global level is the OECD and UN discussions. So we do have, we have the OECD committee and the UN committee, which have been sitting together and deliberating on ways to reach global consensus and come out with a single policy that will help meet consensus at a global level and ensure that all countries have the right to taxation without causing any taxpayers' harassment. Having said this, these are a lot of tax developments that have happened over the last year and so in for digital transactions. There has also been some things that have happened in the regulatory framework. The first one being FDI. This is something that was introduced in the past where FDI specifically deals with e-commerce as a separate section. E-commerce FDI is permitted only for B2B transactions. B2C is not permitted. Also, there is wholesale trading for B2B, which is permitted under trading. So if there is an e-commerce company that is trying to do wholesale trading, they will not have to comply with the e-commerce provisions, but will fall under the trading provisions. Also, B2B e-commerce is only permitted for marketplace models. There are two types. There's a marketplace model and an inventory-based model. Marketplace model is where the e-commerce platform does not really own the goods that is selling. It is just an open marketplace where there are buyers and sellers that come from different places, list their goods and buy and sell. So the platform only facilitates these transactions. However, in an inventory-based model, it's the platform that holds the goods and sells their own goods. They may also sell goods of third parties. So an inventory-based model has been completely struck down. B2B e-commerce is permitted for only marketplace. There are specific conditions and compliances that have come in. However, what's important is today we might wonder if all companies are complying with this FDI regulation. There have been very interesting structures that companies have created and put in place to ensure that the FDI policy can be worked around. Having said this, now that the tax laws have a new provision for e-commerce operators, it is likely that a lot of these companies who will have to comply with Section 194 of the Act will be regarded as an e-commerce operator. So does that mean that they become an e-commerce operator even for the FDI policy? It is something that companies will have to evaluate and should definitely think about, because it's unlikely that before the same government, I say that I am an e-commerce operator for Income Tax Act, but I do not fall under the e-commerce provisions for FDI. That's something that is difficult to stand up with, and therefore it's important for companies to evaluate and see which way they want to swing. Another interesting thing to look forward to is the e-commerce policy, which is due. The draft was issued a couple of years ago that is likely to set specific regulations for e-commerce. This is because, again, the government has recognized how soon and how big the e-commerce sector has grown, and this is the new way of transacting. Looking at all the problems, including tax and regulatory, this policy should come out sometime soon and should help settle some of these ambiguities, and would also assist, would also provide clarifications and assist some of the e-commerce operators in building a stronger presence in the country. A very interesting development are IT digital news and media rules. This is something that caused a lot of stir recently. So what has happened is now the MIB has come up with a new regulation stating that any social media and OTT platforms would be governed by them. And therefore, they have mandated certain things like having a physical contact. So today, some of the largest OTT platforms, social media platforms, do not really have a physical presence in India. Now that has become mandatory that you do have a physical presence in India for local communication. There's also a mandate to appoint a chief compliance officer, a nodal contact and grievance officer in India. This is again to ensure that any complaints arising in India are met in India. There's also an FDI amendment that has been made for digital news media companies, where FDI has been restricted to 26% under the approval route. So these are three very important tax and regulatory developments that came up from the new IT and digital news media rules. What demands attention is the fact that today, if I have a physical presence and if I'm mandated to have employees in India, does it mean that I have a very high PE risk? the Indian courts have been very, very wide when they have discussed PE. There have been, PE has been upheld for various scenarios where there was no physical presence also. However, now that there is a mandate to have a physical presence as well as have employees in India, PE is something that should be evaluated very carefully. Companies will have to check whether they want to start a new group company in India, whether they want to send employees on secondment, and how will they manage the PE risk while they meet the regulatory requirements. So this is something that's very, very interesting and is set to change some of the business models that are currently operating in the country. There are also the data localization norms, with data being the new oil. This is something that was free flowing. It was something that we were all waiting for, is the data protection bill. This is something that's caused uproar across the globe and is not restricted to India. Having recognized this, there have been data localization norms. There is again a mandate that requires companies to have a server in India. There is also the requirement to have data protection officers. So very similar to the previous regulation, this requires both physical presence as well as personnel in India. So again, what does that mean? There could be a very big PE exposure. There is a requirement to relook at it. Also, there with SEP coming in, it does mean that I will be soliciting business. There will be users in India. So does that mean I have a business connection in the country, and will I also be subject to tax? So not only is it a large regulatory concern, but it is also something that should be looked at from the PE and SEP aspect. Having said these and having discussed multiple different taxes that have come in, I thought it would be interesting to go through very few quick case studies that summarizes some of these provisions and also helps us read them together. The first one is electronic delivery of software by non-resident suppliers. This is important to discuss because although the Supreme Court has settled royalty taxation, that was only for physical delivery of goods. As I mentioned, it was for software that was sold through floppies, CDs, etc. So today, when there is electronic delivery, will the provisions of the Supreme Court ruling still hold good? So in this scenario, what happens is there is a foreign company, and there is a distributor who's located in India, and there's an Indian end user. The distributor pays a subscription fee to the foreign company, passes on the software and a license key to the Indian user. What is important to understand here is that although the ruling dealt with the conventional mode of delivery, it is the OECD commentary specifically mentions that method of transferring the software does not matter. It does not matter whether there's physical delivery or whether there's online delivery. So in these scenarios, typically a license key is provided through an email or through another application, and that is enough. There is no real physical movement of goods from one country to another. Therefore, we can uphold the Supreme Court ruling, and we can borrow principles from that ruling to say that such payments should not be software. However, as I mentioned earlier, equalization levy is the new bubble where these transactions would fall into, and therefore the 2% equalization levy will still apply to the foreign company, provided the conditions and threshold limits are met. Second one, which is a very, very common case, is for grant of database access. So today, as an employee of an Indian company, I might be using database of various foreign companies or even my parent company. The Indian company usually pays a license to use this database. The Karnataka High Court in case of Wipro had specifically said that this will be treated as royalty. The Supreme Court ruling has not really looked at a case where there is license agreement. However, it has overruled Karnataka's Samsung ruling, which was the basis for the Wipro ruling. So the Wipro ruling had relied on the Samsung ruling to say that license is royalty. However, as the Supreme Court has struck down the Samsung ruling, can we say that the Wipro ruling can also be relooked at, and can we take a position that even access to database should not be royalty? Again, there is equalization levy that could continue to apply as it is a non-resident transaction. A very similar case is for cloud computing. Again, this is software as a service that is being provided. Is there a way I can say that this is not copyright? I do not have access to the main code that is embedded. It is only the product that I'm using. It is accessing the cloud. It is using the cloud, but I do not really have access to what is behind, to the code that is embedded. These are principles that need to be borrowed from the Supreme Court ruling. Although we may say it's not royalty, but will FTS apply is something that is interesting because this is more of a service transaction. However, there's no human intervention. And we have make available. So there are tax treaties where make available specifically states that only if the service makes available knowledge, then there would be FTS. There is also case laws which say that human intervention is mandatory for something to be taxable as FTS. So where we have some of these benefits available, I can step out of the FTS shoes, but I may again enter equalization levy. The point that we were trying to make across these slides is there are various arguments you can definitely take for software taxation under the Income Tax Act and step out of royalty or FTS. However, equalization levy will then step in. The last and the most interesting case study with regards to software is a reseller model. So this is again something that's very, very commonly used by software companies outside India, where they usually appoint a reseller in India and the reseller then does the final distribution to the Indian customer. There is a CBDT notification that came in 2012, which said that if the reseller in India is complying with the TDS obligations while making the payment to the foreign company, then while the Indian customer makes payments to such reseller, TDS is not required because the original leg of the transaction has already suffered TDS. What's interesting is that now some of these software transactions might be out of royalty because of the Supreme Court ruling, which means that this CBDT circular may no longer hold good, which means that the final Indian customer may now be required to withhold taxes. So today, if I am purchasing software from an Indian reseller, it is important for me to check if TDS has been deducted by him while making the payment to the software company outside India. Where he has taken a no royalty position and has not withheld taxes, then I may be required to withhold taxes. So this is something that's very, very interesting. It's something that companies will have to check and ensure that TDS obligations are complied with to prevent any non-compliance and disallowance in their hands. Having discussed this, now coming to some of the e-commerce transactions, this is where I am a resident customer. I have a resident e-commerce platform. The platform here is outside India, but the seller is in India. So I have a resident seller, I have a resident purchaser, and the platform is outside India. In such a case, I will log on to the platform, which is outside India, make a transaction, and the seller in India will sell me goods. As the seller is located in India, it's typically a transfer of goods from an Indian seller to an Indian purchaser. Therefore, equalization levy will not apply. However, the new provisions of Section 194O, which is TDS at the rate of 1%, will continue to apply. So the online platform in USA, the e-commerce operator in the US, will now be required to withhold taxes on the entire consideration of 1,000 rupees. So this was the point I was trying to make earlier, saying that I have received 1,000 rupees as the sale consideration for goods. However, I'm going to retain only 50 rupees as my fee and pass on the 950 rupees as the sale consideration of the goods being sold. Therefore, the actual income of the online platform is only 50 rupees, but the TDS obligation as it stands today is on the entire 1,000 rupees. Therefore, this could be a massive working capital issue for the online platform outside India, and it continues to be a gross-based taxation. So the online platform will now be required to obtain necessary registrations and deposit taxes on the entire 1,000 rupees. Also, the TCS on GST will continue to apply and will have to be deposited separately. A very similar transaction, but a quick change is this is a non-resident seller. So now we have a non-resident seller, a non-resident platform, and a buyer in India. So today, if I purchase goods from a US platform, and there is a US seller, so I'm purchasing US goods on a US platform, then there is equalization levy because this is typically a transaction with a non-resident seller. So therefore, there is one non-resident, one resident, equalization levy will apply. Where equalization levy applies, TDS under Section 194O and TCS will not apply. Here again, who will be required to do the equalization levy will be the online platform. So again, 1,000 rupees is paid to the online platform. They retain 50 rupees, pass on 950, but equalization levy will apply on the entire 1,000 rupees. This is a clarification that came in the budget that and will have substantial impact because today I will be depositing the entire 2% on 1,000 rupees and that becomes my own tax cost. I might not even get a credit for this because this is outside the ambit of tax treaties. Tax credits are usually claimed from the tax treaties. Equalization levy is not there in the tax treaty. Therefore, the chances of me getting credit for this is much lower. just to compare, previously in a scenario where there was a resident seller, it's still a withholding obligation, so there is a credit mechanism that may be put in place. However, and there is a refund that could be obtained. However, for equalization levy, it is a direct levy on me. I cannot pass this on unless I build it into the invoice value. What we have been seeing is there have been transactions, especially service transactions and software transactions, where the invoice value is marked up by 2% from the non-resident itself. So that way, the non-resident collects 1,000 plus 2% and deposits the 2% and passes on the rest of it. That way, the cost in the books of the non-resident does not increase. However, that does mean that the resident customer ends up paying 2% extra and the cost is borne by an Indian. This was for purchase of goods. A little bit more complicated transaction comes in when there is booking services. So this is where there is a residence. So today, if I want to stay in a hotel in India, I go on to a platform which could be outside India, which connects me to search engines, which are also outside India. So in such a case, I log on, I check a platform, I get connected to a search engine that's outside India to book a hotel in India. So what happens here is the first leg is the transaction flows between the booking platform and the search engine. Both of these being non-residents, there is an equalization levy that applies. This is a specified circumstances because there's a sale of advertisement targeting the Indian customer. So the hotel search engine has popped up a specific advertisement that targeted me to book a hotel in India. Therefore, equalization levy 2 will apply at the rate of 2%. The second leg of transaction is between the booking platform in the US and the Indian hotel. Now, as the service provider, which is the hotel, is located in India, equalization levy won't apply. However, the TDS provision under 194O at 1% and TCS under GST will continue to apply. Only because this is a hotel in India and I am an Indian. So because it's a typical transaction between a resident and resident, on leg two, it will be TDS and TCS that will apply, not equalization levy. However, on leg one, where the transactions were between the booking platform in the US and a non-resident that was targeting in advertisements in India, equalization levy will apply. The same thing comes here is when there is a non-resident. So today, if I want to stay in France and I book a hotel through the same mechanism, everything remains the same. Just that because I'm staying in France, it is a non-resident service provider, equalization levy will apply instead of TDS and TCS. So the main crux of the entire, all the provisions put together is I check whether the service provider or the seller of goods is located in a country outside India or within India. If it is outside India, then there will be an equalization levy that will come into play at 2%. If the provider of services or the supplier of goods is located in India, then there will be a TDS under 194O and a TCS at one and the GST, both at the rate of 1% each. So that's how some of these provisions work. They are a lot more complicated than we wish it would be, but we need to read all of these positions together to understand what are the various provisions that could apply. Also evaluate the tax cost and ensure compliance is made accordingly, because there are specific non-compliance provisions that are there under each of these acts. That's it. So I just thought I'll quickly also show you all the equalization levy challan that is provided. So as I was mentioning, there is a specific requirement to quote the PAN. And there's also in the mode of payment, when we check, it's only an Indian bank account that has to be furnished. This is the same form that is required under equalization levy 1, where the Indian payer is required to deposit taxes, and equalization levy 2, where the foreign e-commerce operator is required to pay the taxes. This is the form 1 of equalization levy. Again, the same form for both equalization levy 1 and 2. It's a simple form where we declare basic details, the total value and equalization levy paid. There is no mechanism for refund or setting of extra equalization levy paid in past years. So that's it from my end here. I'm happy to take any questions that may be. So I see there are a couple of questions here. Can temporary arrangements made by MNC for sale of goods, provision of services through online means during these COVID times fall under EL purview? Yes, Nikhilesh. So there is no specific exemption that's come in for online transactions during COVID. So any arrangement made by MNCs for sale of goods or provision of services, as long as they cross the threshold limit and meet the other conditions, will fall under equalization levy. There is no specific exclusion for COVID. Another question from you is, for the payment of equalization levy, since the NR does not have any presence in India, will the payment burden fall on the Indian arm of the NR, or should the NR comply with it specifically? So I'm presuming this is for equalization levy too. As they do not have a presence in India, as I mentioned, they will have to obtain a permanent account number and have a bank account. With regards to bank account, today there's a facility of opening an SNRR account where you tie up with your foreign bank account that in turn ties up with the Indian bank account and deposits taxes. So you, and if you have an Indian arm, that doesn't really help. You will still have to comply with it as a non-resident. So the option, the obligation of obtaining a PAN, depositing the taxes and making the annual statement all stay with the non-resident. Ravi Garg, given the Supreme Court ruling on software, now payment to NR for software should be subject to equalization levy. Yes, if I am taking this benefit of the Supreme Court ruling for all software transactions, any transaction with a non-resident could be subject to equalization levy, again, subject to the threshold limits. However, it's important I see how far I can apply the Supreme Court ruling, because a lot of the software transactions that we enter into today are substantially different from the software transactions that are discussed in the Supreme Court ruling, but principles can definitely be borrowed. From financial year 22-23 and onwards, can there be a double levy under SEP and EL for the same e-commerce or electronic transactions? Interesting question, Niklesh. Again, here, SEP, whether it's applicable from financial year 21-22 or 22-23 is the first question. There itself, so the provisions were supposed to be applicable from 1st April 2021. The notification with the thresholds that recently came out says 1st April 2022. However, most of the times income tax usually refers to it as assessment year. So whether we read it as assessment year 22 or assessment year 21, 23 is something that we will have to check. Irrespective of from when SEP becomes applicable, there will not be a double levy, because the flow of transactions as it stands today is for, you will first check if it is royalty or FTS. If it is a royalty or FTS transaction, then you will continue to apply those rates. If it is not a royalty FTS transaction, you will come to equalization levy first. If equalization levy is applicable, you will deposit that. Where equalization levy is applicable, it's exempt under the Income Tax Act. So you first check for royalty. If it is no royalty, then you come to equalization levy. If it is yes equalization levy, then nothing under the Income Tax Act will apply. Therefore, SEP will not apply. However, if equalization levy is not applied and then I come to SEP, there could be a chance that there will be an SEP levy. However, again, there could be a tax treaty benefit I can claim if I am transacting with a jurisdiction where there is a valid tax treaty. So it is a complicated flow of events, but the probability of double taxation stays low. Bhamini GS asks, so we understand that as per section 916, software would still be liable to tax. Assuming that I cannot take DTAA benefit, then should I still deduct TDS on this as per the Act? Also, Form 15CB is still required for this. As per 91, as per the software royalty provisions, software was always taxed under royalty. However, we now, based on the Supreme Court ruling, if I am transacting with a non-resident, I have a tax treaty, I can take benefit of the Supreme Court ruling and say that it will not be royalty taxation. So if I'm claiming this benefit, then the provisions as they stand today is I take the more beneficial between the Act and the treaty. I can use the Supreme Court ruling, go back to the treaty reading and say that it's not royalty. So if I'm doing that, then obviously there is no obligation. If you cannot take the DTAA benefit, even then there are good arguments for you to borrow principles from the Supreme Court ruling and say that it is not royalty. On a conservative basis, if I continue to take a position that the payment I'm making is in the nature of royalty and the Supreme Court principles do not apply, then yes, there will be a requirement to withhold taxes under Section 195. And the Form 15CB requirement will continue as it would have. Ranjit, sorry, just give me a second. Ranjit Bhatt asks, if I have my own website and I sell my own goods or services, what provisions will apply? So Ranjit, if you are a non-resident selling your own goods or providing services through your own website, then equalization levy will apply, subject to obviously the threshold that is mentioned of 2 crore. In case you do not, and that is subject to, if it is services, you'll obviously first have to check if FTS applies. If FTS does not apply, then equalization levy will apply. The only difference here is that earlier, if FTS was applicable, you will just do a withholding. Only if FTS is not applicable, there's now an equalization levy. So one amongst the two will apply. If you are a resident and you have your own website and you're selling goods or services, then the new TDS provisions of 194O won't apply. There could, if you are selling goods, there could be the TDS provision under 194O, that 194Q that comes in. And if it is services, then you have the regular TDS provisions that will apply. How can equalization levy provisions apply for software imports without e-commerce operators? So Ranjit, again, equalization levy applies irrespective of whether you are transacting through an operator or you are transacting through your own website. So unlike the domestic provisions under 194O, the e-commerce operator under equalization levy is defined to mean anyone that is transacting through an online platform. So even if I am selling something through my own website, equalization levy will apply, subject to the 2 crore threshold. There's no need of having a third party operator. My own website is good enough. If that, however, that benefit is provided under the domestic laws. Whether recent equalization levy provisions 2.0 apply for B2C? Yes, they apply to B2C also. Again, this doesn't really have any implications for the customer in India, because the obligation to deposit equalization levy 2.0 is on the foreigner. So if you are a foreign supplier of goods or providing services, then you will be required to pay the 2% tax. There's no obligation on the Indian seller. So today, as an individual, if I am entering into a transaction where equalization levy applies, there's nothing I need to do differently. There's only a requirement for the foreign service provider to deposit these taxes. The only impact it could have is there have been instances where the foreign companies have marked up 2% on the total invoice value. So the total amount I'm shedding from my pocket might be higher by 2%. Apart from that, there's no other obligation that's cast on me. Next question is, company is resident in India who sells goods through its website, but the website is hosted on Shopify Canada. Every month, money gets deducted automatically from the company's bank account towards subscription fee and cloud fee, which tax is applicable on these payments. So here you are paying for website hosting services, which is something that was discussed while we were looking at the software transactions. So here again, the company will have to take a view whether they are saying web hosting services is in the nature of royalty or FTS or not. Where you take a royalty FTS provisions, you will have to take the TDS rate as per the tax treaty with Canada or India, whichever is more beneficial. If that is not done, if I take a no royalty and FTS position, Shopify Canada will be required to pay 2% equalization levy in India. So there again, if I take a no royalty position, the obligation is moved on to Shopify Canada to deposit equalization levy. Next question is by Mr. P.V. Venugopal Menon. If Indian company reimburses goods or services which they pay for using their individual credit card, what is liability of the Indian company for any of the TDS or equalization level liabilities? Indian company pays their own individual. So I presume this is where Indian company is. So today as an employee, if I am purchasing software through online modes and the Indian company is reimbursing it for me, I will have to check whether the individual person has. So again, this is a typical reimbursement scenario. Reimbursement itself has been a matter of constant litigation. The basic principle there being that if the original leg of the transaction has suffered TDS, then the reimbursement should not suffer TDS. In a typical scenario like this, where the purchase is being made by the individual and the amount is being reimbursed by the Indian company, I'm presuming there will not be any TDS that has been done by the individual. So the Indian company that's reimbursing should deposit taxes if the transaction is subject to royalty FTS. In any of the two scenarios, there will always be an equalization levy that will be applicable for the foreign company where there is no TDS being done in India. The next question is by Mr. Ganpat Raj. No, okay, that's not a question. Thank you, Mr. Ganpat. Mr. P.V. Menon, again, in my earlier query, reimbursement is to the employer. Yes, I understood. When I have my own website and sell my own inventory, whether I will still be called as e-commerce operator for TCS under GST? Ranjit, no. So if you have your own website, you will not be required to comply with TCS under GST or with section TDS under 194O. For both of these provisions, the website should firstly be in India. I'm presuming that this is a resident Indian transacting with another resident. In both this, both of these, TCS and TDS will not apply. Because of the fact that you need to have three parties for both of these transactions. So you need to have an e-commerce platform, a buyer and a seller. If it is a transaction through your own website, then both TDS under section 194O and TCS under GST will not apply. Moving on. What is the TDS liability of a company when a subscription is made by using corporate credit card? Aruna, the liability remains the same. If you are taking a royalty position, then you have the regular TDS on royalty that will apply. If there is a no royalty position being taken, then there's no obligation on the company but an equalization levy for the foreign company. So there's nothing that changes for subscriptions made using corporate credit card. What matters is the underlying transaction and whether we take a royalty position or a no royalty position based on the Supreme Court ruling. How to check whether any transaction as royalty or FTS? So this is something that's I wish it was as simple as it should be, but so royalty or FTS are specifically defined under the Income Tax Act as well as the tax treaty. So if I'm undertaking a transaction with a foreigner, then I'll have to first read the Income Tax Act where royalty is specifically defined. There's also a specific definition under usually Article 12 of the tax treaty. So based on the country with whom I'm interacting, I'll have to check the tax treaty, evaluate whether my transaction meets the definition of royalty and FTS. And I can obviously take whichever of the two definitions are more beneficial or the tax rates are more beneficial between the tax treaty as well as the domestic tax law, I can take that. And that's how I conclude on my tax liability as royalty or FTS. I have a few more questions. Some of these are repeated, so I'll just pick the ones that are not. How can equalization levy provisions apply for software imports without e-commerce operator? Again, equalization levy does not require a third-party e-commerce operator. Transactions through their own website. Forget even a website today. If I'm placing order for a software through an email and that gets delivered to me online, that itself is sufficient for equalization levy to apply. Again, this is equalization levy applicable in hands of the non-resident. There is no obligation for the Indian party. One last question by Bharat Purohit. For TCS under section 206C1H, whether turnover to be computed as sale of goods and income from other sources, or whether we have to consider only sale of goods or turnover for applicability of TCS from seller perspective, this is only turnover from the sales perspective. It says sales receipts, turnover, or gross receipts, so therefore only your total revenue from operations is what is considered for TCS under section 206. One more question by Ranjit again. Since I'm taking the benefit of the treaty for software, what position should I take for non-provision of no PE certificate or tax residency certificate? Okay, so Ranjit, basically, if you are taking any benefit under the tax treaty, it is important for you to obtain a tax residency certificate from the vendor as well as a no PE declaration. This is because of the simple fact that for the foreigner to claim, it is the foreign company that's claiming the tax benefit under the treaty. For them to be eligible to claim such a benefit, it is mandatory for them to have a tax residency certificate. And this is because they need to prove that they are a resident of the other company, therefore eligible to claim benefit under the tax treaty. The no PE certificate is also required because only if they have a no PE, then Article 12 of Royalty FTS gets triggered. If they have a PE, then you know, that means that everything is taxable as business profits, which is why the tax residency certificate and OPE certificate become important documents. The tax residency certificate is a must-have because that's the only way you can prove that the foreign company is eligible to take the tax treaty benefit. In case they do not furnish a tax residency certificate and OPE certificate, they should be denied benefits under the tax treaty, and TDS should be done at the higher rate. If that is not done and it cannot be proven, then there could be disallowance in the hands of the Indian company. I think that's the last question that is there here. I'm happy to take any other question that is required.
Manish, any other questions available there? Manish or Suraj, who is there? Otherwise, you finished, Ashita?
Yes, sir. Just quick question. Will this PPT be circulated? A lot of requests for the.
Okay,
PPT.
Please share with us so that we'll share, upload in the site. They can see, sure. And they can download where and whoever wants. We don't, sure, mail it, we upload in the resources.
Okay, sure. No problem. I think there's one more question that's come up. Let me just quickly check.
Yeah.
If seller of goods sells goods locally through his own built e-commerce platform for generating leads, but managed by another e-commerce operator like say Shopify, how will TCS and TDS under Section 194 OD construed? Again, Shweta, here we'll have to identify who the three. So again, this is a three-party transaction. We will have to identify who the e-commerce operator is, who the seller is, who the buyer is. The e-commerce operator through which the sales is facilitated and through whom the payment is made will be required to comply with the TDS and TCS obligation. So if I have my own website that is a platform that is managed by another platform, what is important is where are my goods and services listed and through which platform am I undertaking this transaction. It is that platform that will be required to comply with TDS and TCS. One very key difference between TDS and TCS is TDS under Section 194O will apply even if the payment is made through the e-commerce platform or directly. However, TCS under GST will only apply if the payment is routed through the e-commerce platform. So if I make a direct payment to the seller or to the service provider, TCS does not apply. So that's one small difference between TCS and TDS. But the key point here is to identify who the operator is through whom I am transacting. And that is the person that will be required to meet the TDS TCS obligation. That's it, sir. As of now, I don't think there are any more.
Okay, thank you very much. Friends, I just have some information to give to all the members, viewers here. Bangalore branch, along with the Karnataka State Chartered Accountants Association, formed a COVID care task force. The idea is to collect donation from generous donation from our members and purchase oxygen concentrator and give it to our MP Tejasvi Surya. He is, and his team is going to manage that. And some of the oxygen concentrator may be available for our members and their family members if at all required. So that is the plan we had, and we announced and made sent out mails and SMSs to all the members, both KSEAA and branch also sent it. We have collected a good amount, more than 20 lakhs we have collected, and we have already placed the order for this oxygen concentrator. In 2-3 days time, around 15 machines we are going to receive it, which we are giving it to Tejasvi Surya, our MP from Bangalore South constitution. He's and his team is going to manage that. That information I wanted to inform, that donation portal still open. We want to keep it till end of this week. So whoever is interested to contribute for this noble cause, I humbly request, please make your contribution. Your generous contribution really helps the needy. So a lot of problem is there, particularly in oxygen and COVID care. This is the initiative of the Bangalore branch and KSEA. Many chartered accountants already contributed. If anyone is able to contribute, please contribute to Bangalore branch. It is still open. Okay, with that note, I hope we all had an excellent session from Ashita Ketan about taxability of digital and e-commerce transactions. We thank on behalf of Bangalore branch and on behalf of all the participants, our wholehearted thanks to Ashita. Thank you very much, Ashita.
Thank you, sir. Thank you everyone for attending. Please take care. Stay safe.
Yeah.
Hope to meet physically in the next study session.
Yes, please take care and stay safe. Once again, thanks to all our viewers. Thank you very much. You are the reason for this program. Your overwhelming support and participation made us to conduct many more programs. Keep visit bangaloreica.org for all our future programs. Thank you very much. Good night. Thanks, Ashita. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Bye-bye.